Okay, so we're going to go through the practice SAC for year 11 general math univariate data. I don't want to be involved. Shh, thank you. All right, so I'm going to jump over to the first page, which is multiple choice, and it asks, a survey asks respondents to state, A survey asks respondents to state the number of children in their family. The level of measurement of this variable is. So it's talking about what sort of data is being collected here. So if you're being asked how many children are in your family, that is a countable piece of data, right? Because you can probably count it. Most of you with just your fingers will be able to count it, meaning that it's a discrete numerical piece of data, right? It's numerical because it's a number, not a word, and it's discrete because it's countable, not measured. So should be a discrete numerical data. A bar chart is the most suitable graphical display for. Now, the difference commonly between a bar chart and a histogram is better for numerical data. Bar charts are better for categorical data. So looking at the data we have here, we've got categorical, discrete, numerical, continuous, numerical, nominal, or none of the above. So the correct one should just be categorical. All right. So it's fine. It's fine for nominal data as well. There's no real issue for that. But I guess overall, A is a more correct answer. Okay, next question. Now, a group of 50 students were asked to choose between swimming, diving, or basketball for a sport. And the results are given in the table below. There's swimming, diving, basketball, each with 25, 5, and 20, respectively. The percentage of students who did not want to play basketball is. So not means basically everything but basketball. So if basketball is 20 and the total is 50, everything that is not not basketball is 30, right? And I can just add them up, but usually if you have like a bigger data set, maybe you've got like 5 or 6 responses, it's quicker to just minus the one that you don't want away rather than add them all up. So it'll save you a little bit of time. So 30 people would prefer not to do basketball. Now, to put this in a percentage, the total is 50, which is 30 over 50, right? I put that into my calculator and type it up, and I'm going to get 0.6 times that by 100, and that's going to give me 60%. And that 60% is the correct answer for that one. Let's turn over. Oh, I've got two there. All right, so the next one we are looking at a histogram talking about number of students and their weekly food expenditure in dollars, summarized in the histogram attached. So it's asking for the number of people, so the key being number, not percentage, the number of people who spent less than $100 per week is equal to what? Right? Now the $100 per week line is this line here, right? So anybody who spent less than that is between 0 and 100. So the number of people who spent less than $100 per week is purely this column here, which you can see is equal to 40. So 40 is the correct answer. Okay, we have that one. The shape of the distribution. So we're talking about the shape. Now, if you remember back from when I was talking about shape and how to look at shape, you can describe shape by its skewedness, positive or negative. And the positive skewedness is where it sort of looks like you can like walk downstairs and it's pretty like comfortable. Like that's an easy way to walk down. Whereas negative, we're lazy. We don't want to walk up the stairs. All right, so that's positive skewed. The other things in here to look at, symmetric, it's not symmetrical because it's not in the middle. Bimodal means there are two most common answers that are equal in value. This one only has one, so it can't be that. Okay, so positively skewed is the correct answer for that one. Okay, the next one says the median amount spent per year by this group is in which interval? Now, this is one that might take a little bit of thinking to solve. The idea being that if there are 104 people, right, and we solve it almost similarly to how we just solve median regularly, there are 104 people, if you look at my data here, and that means that the middle value is, remember we use the formula 100 and or whatever the total number is plus 1 divided by 2 will tell us what's in the middle. So we're looking in the middle of 105 divided by 2, what's that, 52 and 53? So whatever's in the middle of the 52nd and 53rd value is considered to be our median, right? So if I want to figure out what group that's in, if these are in order from smallest to largest, and we don't know the exact values, but that's okay. We know the first 40 people are under 100, so it can't be there, right? Because we're looking for the 52nd and 53rd person. So the first 40 people can't be there. The next lot, there's 45 people, meaning in order, persons number 41 to 85 are in that group, which means by that logic, persons 52 and 53 are also in that group, if that makes sense, right? So if we've counted all these up, these are 40, we count up these first 10, we're 50. If people number 52 and 53 are right here, means that they're in that group, okay? So they're in the group of 100 to 200, or 100 to less than 200, is where you will find the median for that group. Next one, we have a group of 21 managers was asked what age they began working for their current employer, and their response is shown in the stem plot below. And there's a little key here to tell us that a stem of 1 and a leaf of 7 means the number 17. So it was a good idea to keep an eye on the key, not so much with ages, but with other things, because it could be like 170 or something. So just keep an eye on it. Okay, so this is the stem plot below. The median age at which the managers began working for their current employer. So again, we're looking for median, which is middle. If there are 21 managers, to find the median, I do 21 plus 1 divided by 2, which means the 11th age in order is our median. So I'm just going to go through and count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. That is our median person there. So that's what? The age is 25. All right. The next one asks the interquartile range of these ages. And what that is. So again, for interquartile range, we're just finding the median of each half that we've created when we're looking for our median, all right? So here I have 10 values on this side. So 10 plus 1 divided by 2 means the 5.5th value, or meaning between the 5th and the 6th values, is where I'll find my Q1. And then I do the same for the upper half, right? So to find interquartile range, remember the formula is Q3 minus Q1. And to do that, I'm finding the median of each half. So between my 5th and 6th value, so I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 is 19, and my 6th value is 20, meaning that my Q1 lies between 19 and 20. So what's between 19 and 20? 19.5. Meaning my Q1 is 19.5, and my Q3, again, is between the 5th and 6th value of the upper half. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so between 30 and 31, which would be what? 30.5. Meaning our interquartile range is 11, right? Cool. So I've written that out a shot. There we go. Just so that makes a bit of sense. Let's keep going. All right, the next one is a dot plot, which gives the sizes of 13 different classes at school. The percentage of classes with at least 23 students is closest to, meaning 23 or more. At least means There is a minimum of 23 kids in this class, right? So essentially we're looking at from this point onwards, yeah? So we're looking for at least 23 kids. So that's what? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 students out of a possible, or 5 classes out of a possible 13. And I'm trying to do that maths in my head and I'm struggling a little bit. It is like 0.3 something. I'll just bring up my CAS and chuck that in. So now you can't see it in the recording, but I'm just typing in 13 divided by 5. Oh. Gives me 2.6. No, hang on, I've done that the wrong way around. So 5 divided by 13. Never mind, that's me being stupid. 0.38. Right, multiply that by 100. It gives you 38.4%. Right, 38.4%. Which rounds down to 38, meaning that C is my correct answer. All right. Oops, I've gone a little bit blurry. Okay. The next one says the following data set represents the number of hours spent watching television in a week by a group of students. We're looking for the mean and standard deviation for this data. So I might actually bring up the CAS properly on screen then, just for this one, because this is all CAS. And I'll just jump over to here and let's find out that information. So I'm going to go on the wrong setting. There it is. Okay, I'm just going to go back to the home page and into our lists and spreadsheets. And in here, I'm going to type in our data. So it's TV time. I'm just going to put TV as our label and I'm going to fill in our data. We have 15, 3, 25, 29, 10, 11, 0, and 33. All right, so there are our 8 pieces of data, right? And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to solve for our one variable statistics, right? Because that gives us all the information that we need for this topic. So if you're able to do this, you're going to have no problems answering these things. So I'm going to go into menu, statistics, stat calculations, one variable statistics. And it's going to ask us how many lists we're looking at. We're only looking at one. And that list is called TV. The frequency we leave alone. We're going to leave these two as well. And our results are going to come out in column B. We hit OK. And here it gives us our information. Now, the things that it's asking for, if we go, that's the wrong page. The thing that it's asking for, if I flick back over here, it's asking for mean and standard deviation, which is this like X with a hat and also S with a little x next to it. Okay? So that's what we're looking for on our CAS. Let's go back, look here. Similar to, there's our S of X, right? So that's our standard deviation. We need to find our mean, which is this one. So we have 15.75. and 12.10 are our two values that we need. So let's go back to our test. What do we have? 15.75, and I've already forgotten the other value. 15.75 and 12.1. So 15.75 rounds up to 15.8, right? And our other one was 12.1. So our answer is C in that circumstance. All right, cool. Easy. Let's jump over to the box plot. All right, so we're looking at this box plot here. And it says the height in centimeters of members of a hockey club is given by the following box plot. Okay, and it's asking you some questions about this box plot. It's saying the interquartile range of this distribution is closest to what? So looking here, remember the interquartile range of a box plot is the width of the box, because that box represents Q1, median, and Q3. So I would say the top end, we're looking at roughly 179, and the bottom end, you're looking at roughly 165. So we're sort of looking at about 14 centimeters. Looking at our options here, 15 is the closest, so I'm going to say 15. So that's C. Okay? And that's just measuring it up as close as I can with my eyes. Okay? So that was 179 take 165 gave me 14. There is no 14. 15 is the closest. And the diagram's not 100% clear, so I'm assuming that it's 15. Okay? I will say if you do get a question like that on the SAC and it's a bit ambiguous as to which one it is, as long as you show you're working out, you'll get the mark. It's okay. Okay? So, question 12 says the heights of members of a hockey club were separated into male and female, and the distributions are shown using the following box plots. So which of the following statements are not true? Are not true. So we're looking for things that are wrong. It says the females tend to be shorter than the males. That appears to be true from the data we're looking at. The tallest of the female players is slightly above average for males, but the shortest female is significantly shorter than the males. So A is correct. The shortest male is taller than the median height for females. So the shortest male here, are they taller than the median height? Well, the median height's just below here, so yeah. The smallest male is taller than the average female in this team. So that's correct. C, the heights of the males is more variable than the heights of the females. So more variable, for a box plot, we mean more spread out. So in this case, that's not true. The males are more closely clumped together, right? They are less variable, whereas the females are really spread out, right? So C is incorrect. Just make sure the rest of them are right. The shortest person is a female. That's correct. Whoever this person is here is quite short. And the median of the heights are not the same, which is also true, because the median of the heights are quite different, meaning that C has to be the correct answer. All right, let's move on. We just finished the multiple choice. All right. So we're looking at the first of the extended response, and what we're doing is we're looking at the birth rates per 100,000 for 20 different countries in 2002, and it's asking what sort of level of measurement is the variable birth rate. This one we actually had a little bit of discussion about. I can't remember who it was that we were sort of like, is it counted or is it something that is measured? I guess counted was the more correct. But what they're actually asking for is it numeric or categorical? And it's numeric, right? So it's numeric. If you would like to go a step further, I think the most accurate would be to say that it is discrete, because it would have been like head counts and stuff like that. But numeric on its own was enough to get you the mark, okay? Okay, so we have to make now an ordered stem leaf plot for both sets. So to do that, I need to put my data in order, which is annoying because there's not a whole lot of room to do it. So I'm just going to sort of do it at the top of the page here. So I'm going to put my data in order from smallest to largest. I think my smallest values are all 9. Then we've got an 11. A 12, a 13, a 14,16, 17, we have 18, another 18, 19, 20, 22, 27, 28, 35, 38, 41, and 50. All right, so that's my data put in order now. I would usually advise if you come across a question like this and you know you're gonna have to do some stuff with a data set like this, just save yourself the time, put it in order to begin with, because you know you're gonna have to do it later anyway. It'll make it easier. Okay, now I'm doing a stem and leaf plot. It doesn't give me any information regarding like whether they want full stems or those half stems with the asterisk. It doesn't say. So I feel like it's going to let me choose. In this case, because of how the data is varying, I'm just going to use regular stems. So I'm going to use the stems 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right? If they're getting you to draw your stem plot from scratch, you will also get a mark for doing the what do you call it, not the legend, what's it called, the key, thank you, where you say like 1-7=17, something like that. You'll get a mark for getting that on there correctly, so just make sure you do it even if you're not sure whether or not it's going to be marked. And then we're going to go through and put in our values. We got 9, 9, 9. Now keep in mind, when you're drawing this out, these need to be in like straight columns, right? It needs to be neat, otherwise it's too hard to read. So we've got 9, 9, 9. We've got 11, 12, 13, 14, 16, 17, 18, 18, 19, 20, 22, 27, 28, 35, 38, 41, and 50. All right? So see how I've tried to keep it relatively straight? The idea is you should be able to see the distribution while you're looking at it. And if you think of it this way as well, you turn this bad boy on the side, you got yourself a histogram, right? It's probably a little hard to see, but it's like a histogram, yeah? And it shows you. Does that make sense? It looks the same. So yeah, I think that's just something worth noting. So that's our stem and leaf, done. Easy marks. Construct a dot plot. Keep in mind it says dot plot, don't misread it. It's not saying box plot. And you have to just go through and dot out your data. So for 9, we had 1, 2, 3. We had an 11, a 12, a 13, a 14, 16, 17, we had two 18s, 19, 20, we've got a 22 and a 27, 28, 35, a 38, a 41, and a 50. Now, personally, I hate dot plots. I think they are the worst data representation ever, but they do something that the stem plot doesn't do well, which is it shows us how spread out our data is, and also gives us an idea if there were going to be outliers, for example. Right, we get a rough idea from that information. So it is somewhat useful. What's the mode of the distribution? Meaning, what is the most frequent answer? In this case, it is 9. What percentage of countries have birth rates greater than 30? Right, meaning 30 or more. So I measure, like I did before, from 30 all the way up to the top. That's only 4 out of however many countries we looked at. 20 countries. That's 4 out of 20. I put 4 divided by 20 into my CAS, and I will get 0.2. Times that by 100, and I will get 20%. Yeah? Cool? I'm not showing that on the screen. Sorry, guys. So that's 20%. Okay. Move across to the next bit. Construct a histogram with the data with intervals of width equal to 10. There's a question before that. Calculate the median and interquartile range for birth rates of the 20 countries. All right, so I need the Q1, the median, the Q3, and then I use the Q1 and the Q3 to give me the IQR. Yeah? That's what I'm looking for. So I need median first. So if there are 20 countries, we do 20 plus 1 divided by 2 is 21 divided by 2, which is 10.5, meaning between the 10th and the 11th country in order is where I'm going to find my median. So let's jump back over here. Between the 10th and 11th countries, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Luckily for us, they are both 18, meaning the Q1 is 18. No, sorry, what am I doing? The median. The median is 18. Yeah? So that was between the two eights here. So I can signify that by putting like a little line in between them. Now I got to find essentially the median of the lower and upper halves, and that's my Q1 and Q3. So my lower half, I have how many countries? 10? 10 countries? Plus 1 divided by 2 means between the 5th and 6th countries, right? Between the 5th and 6th, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So between 12 and 13 is 12.5. Similarly, I find between the 5th and 6th of the upper half. Sorry, I've got like things out of shot here. Between the 5th and 6th of the upper half of the data, so I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So between 27 and 28 is 27.5. Meaning the interquartile range is equal to 27.5 minus 12.5, which in this case is 15. All right, so that's our median and interquartile range. Let's do our histogram. Okay, so constructing a histogram with intervals of 10. Luckily, our graph already has that. If that doesn't have that, it's just meaning this bottom bit, the bin width is what they call it, is equal to 10. Okay, so they're grouped into 10s. So our first piece of data from 0 to 10, we can actually get straight from our stem plot here. So 0 to 10. Is just those three nines. So we go up to 3 here, we draw that down, That's our first one. Our next one, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 values. And going all the way up here and down. Yep. Our next one, we've got, 4? It's about here and down. Our next one, between 30 and 40, we have 2. And down. 40 to 50, we have 1. And down. And 50 to 60, we have 1. Okay? So that's our histogram. Remember, the key with histogram is they need to be like conjoined, essentially. What am I trying to say? Bar charts are separate. Histograms are all pushed together. What's the shape of this distribution?
Positively skewed.
Because we're lazy, we don't like to walk upstairs, we like to walk downstairs. And for the most part, this is downstairs, right? It sort of like trails off this way, meaning that it is positively skewed. Right. How many countries had birth rates from 10 per thousand to less than 20 per thousand? So that's this section here. Right. So 10 per thousand to 20 per thousand, that is 9. Let's keep going. All right. All right, so question 2. We have a survey of 30 young people, not unlike yourselves. They are asked if they would like to have a car or not, or whether they were unsure. And the data looked a bit like this. So Y means yes, they wanted to buy a car. N means no, they weren't interested. And U means they're not sure yet. And it's shown in this table below. So we're going to use a frequency table with the options yes, no, and unsure. All right? Sorry, that's supposed to be a U. It looks almost like another N. Yes, no, and unsure. So we're just going to go through and count how many of each. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 yeses. There are 16?
Yeah.
I counted wrong. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. You're right. There is 16. 10 no's. 1, 2, 3, 4. Got mixed up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Then there should be 4 unsures if you've done it right. 1, 2, 3, 4. Which means the total adds up to 30. There are 30 young people as per the question. So we know that we've done that correctly. Yeah? So, for example, if I just went with that 15 and I added up all those numbers, I would have had 29, and I know that I stuffed up somewhere. So be sure that you do your total. All right. We represent them now using a bar chart. Now, there are 2 marks here. I believe one is for getting the correct shape of a bar chart, and one of them is for the correct values. So people that do this like a histogram are going to lose marks. So meaning, at the bottom here, I'm going to have one thing for yes, one thing for no, one thing for unsure. Right? And they are their own individual pillars. They are not joined. So for yes, we have 16. Which looks like that. For no, we have 10. And for unsure, we had 4. All right? And that's how you get your marks. Yeah? So one for doing the correct values, one for not having it pushed together like a histogram. Cool? They're labeled at the bottom. You'd have to label it. Yeah. Cool. All right. Let's jump on to the next one. Biologist recorded reaction times of people in seconds, 13 people, and they had the values. Find five-figure summary statistics. Now, if you can't remember, the five-figure summary is min, Q1, median, Q3, and max. All right? Now, I should be able to fill in two of those values immediately. The min being the lowest, which that's not in order, but it looks like 4. And the max being the highest, which appears to be 18. All right? I'm going to quickly put these in order underneath to make sure that they're all right. So we had 4, 4, 4. Only 3 4s. And we got 6, 6, 6. 3 8s. 8, 8, 8. 8. We've got 2 10s, a 12, and an 18. Hopefully I did that right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 people. Wonderful. All right, so that's in order. So our min is 4, our max is 18. We've got to find our median. The formula for median is the number of people being 13 plus 1 divided by 2. Means the seventh person in order is our median. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which means our median is 8. Okay? Now I have to essentially take that 8 out of it, because that's our median, and find the median of the upper and lower halves. So the median of the first half, we have 6 values now. 6 plus 1 divided by 2 means that between the third and fourth, between the third and fourth values, I will find my answer, which is 1, 2, 3, 4. What's between 4 and 6? 5. Wonderful. And same for the upper half, 1, 2, 3, 4. Between 10 and 10, it's just 10. And that's my five-figure summary done.
So are we going to get CAS calculators in the
SAC? Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So yeah, you can do this on the CAS as well. I just think it's quicker to do it by hand, but... Okay, the reaction time of 18 seconds is considered to be an outlier. Show why 18 is an outlier. Remember the formula for checking outliers, we need to find the upper and lower fences. So the upper fence is what we're going to be looking for because 18 is above the median. So the upper fence is we have Q3 plus 1.5 times the IQR, right? And that'll tell us whether or not 18 is an outlier. So in this case, our Q3 is 10, plus our interquartile range is 10 minus 5, so 1.5 times 5, means that our fence is 10 plus 1.5 times 5 is 7.5, meaning anything above 17.5 is considered an outlier. So 17 is our fence. I might say therefore, that's what that little arrow means, therefore 18 is an outlier.
Can you just say 18 is above the upper fence?
Sure. Yeah, so just ask to prove why. So that's what we've done. We found the fence, and that proves it, okay? And you don't need to find the lower fence because we're only looking at above, okay?
Sorry?
Sure. Just here. No, that's all right. Okay, so now we're going to use that five-figure summary to create a box plot to have a look at our reaction time data, right? And a box plot is actually quite easy once you've got your five-figure summary. The only thing we have to remember is that we have an outlier which we change how it looks. Okay? And the outlier is not represented in there. Sorry. Okay. So we have our min is 4, our Q1 is 5, our median is 8, and our Q3 is 10. I'm going to leave max for a second because we have an outlier. So min was 4. Our Q1 is 5. Our median is 8. Our Q3 is 10. We're going to join them up. Thank you. Now, because 18 is an outlier, with my whisker at the top end, I'm not going all the way up to 18, right? Because that's considered to be out of the regular data. So if I were doing reaction times, maybe if I pick people at random, this 18 reaction time might be an older person or something like that. And it's not a clear indication of the data, right? So that 18, I represent it's an outlier just by putting a little cross there. That means that this is an outlier, but it is still a piece of our data, right? Which means it's still considered useful, just not in the box plot. So if my max is 18, but that's an outlier, that means that my whisker has to go out to whatever is before 18. So my next highest, which in this case is 12. So my whisker only goes out to 12. And that's my box and whisker plot, right? So that's it. You don't include that.
Why does it go to 12, sorry?
So 18 is considered to be an outlier.
Yeah.
Meaning that you put a little cross where that is. So you need to go to the next highest piece of data to draw your whisker out to. Because you don't include that 18 in the whisker. All right? I'll give you a moment if you have to copy that down. Let's keep motoring along. We don't have long to go. Last page. All right. This is a common question that you get in this sort of data. It's just to show your understanding. So, thank you. It's going to ask you to talk about shape, center, spread, and outliers, which is pretty normal when we're talking about distributions. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at, we'll do center first. So thank you. The measure of center that we're using for the box plot is median, because we already have that value. So we would say in terms of, or something like this, it doesn't have to be exact. In terms of center, the data for reaction time had a median of 8, right? That's my measure of center, okay? I can talk about spread. So spread, you generally use IQR or range. It's up to you. Thank you. So for spread, we can use either. Doesn't matter. To be clear, for measure of center, you can use mean if you would like, but we already had the median, so there's no point. I'd say in terms of spread, the data had a range of, and this is just me flexing, giving a great answer, by the way, has a range of 14. And I'm going to put, however, due to outliers, IQR is a better measure. I'll draw you a picture if you do that on your test. I'll take the time to draw you a picture that you'll enjoy. Okay. Due to the outliers, IQR is a better measure of center. Thank you. Spread. Better measure of spread. That was a test. At, I think it was 5. Just check that. Yeah, that's right. At 5. So I've talked about center and spread, and now I have to talk about outliers. And I'll say this data had one outlier in 18 or whatever the value was. Had one layer in 18 present. And that's it. And you can really word that however you want. You just got to get out those points, right? So you want to say that, and I like to write as a nice paragraph, but you want to get it out to say that the measure of center, use either the mean or the median, whichever you like, whichever you think's more appropriate. Generally speaking, if you have an outlier, median is better. So you could have flexed again on that question if you like, but use median or mean for the first one. Measure spread, use range or IQR. Again, IQR is better if there are outliers. And then you talk about if there are outliers present. You get those things out and you're done. So, that's everything. And if you did all that, you get 100%. So, good job.